much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your love, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
And we're going to do it a little differently than usual. I will start with prayer and leave us some time for reflection and confession within our hearts and minds. And then the praise band will lead us in a song that continues our prayer to God. Let us pray. God, we give you thanks that in these waters of baptism, you forgive us, and that we can come before you confident as children of God, that even in the midst of our brokenness, we can come and confess and receive grace, mercy, and love.
Please sing with me.
We've prayed the prayer with no reply. Words float off into the night. We've cut our doubts with the sharpest knife. Oh, God, forgive us. Oh, God, forgive us. To our uncertainty, help us with our unbelief. Oh, God, forgive us. Christ, you are the bread of life. Thirst and hunger you provide. We forget.
Be confident that God hears our prayer and forgives us of all of our confessions. In God's mercy, amen. Michelle is reminding me that at this time I welcome you. So, welcome. Welcome to service. Welcome as we begin the season of Lent, as we head into these 40 days to Easter. We're glad to have you here. Today we are reflecting on Jesus's words saying, I am the bread of life. So all through Lent, we're doing a sermon series that looks at his I am statements in the Gospel of John. So today we're talking about I am the bread of life. So we're glad to have you here. If you're visiting with us, you can fill out a yellow card in your seats as we continue to sing.
Forever. the children that Moses led. God's gonna trouble the water. Wait in the water. Wait in the water, children. Wait in the water. God's gonna trouble the water. Trouble the water. Wait in the water. Wait in the water, children. Wait in the water. God's gonna trouble the water. The children that's coming through. God's gonna trouble the water.
Sunday school, so they can head out with Miss Betsy to Sunday school. As we invite the Racette family up for baptism, as we heard that song, Wade in the Water, it's what we're headed into for Arabella. And next time we sing that, I expect a little swagger, y'all. You know, a little more movement with that rhythm as we sing it. We are rejoicing in this moment for Arabella, who looks absolutely ready. She's looking great. And we remember that God, who is rich in mercy and love, gives us a new birth into a living hope through the sacrament of baptism. By water and the word, God delivers us from sin and death and raises us to new life in Jesus Christ. We are united with all the baptized in the one body of Christ, anointed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, and joined in God's mission for the life of the world. So I ask, who is presented to be baptized on this day? Who is yawning right now? Arabella May, called by the Holy Spirit, trusting in the grace and love of God, do you desire to have your child baptized into Christ? You may say, we do. As you bring your child to receive the gift of baptism, you are entrusted with responsibilities to live with her among God's faithful people, bring her to the Word of God and the Holy Spirit, teach her the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments, place in her hands the Holy Scriptures, and nurture her in faith and prayer, so that she may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others and the world God made, work for justice and peace? Do you promise to help Arabella grow in the Christian faith and life? We do. And people of God, now we make our own promises. Do you promise to support Arabella and pray for her in her new life in Christ, knowing that with this responsibility, you are promising to heal and serve this daughter by the power of the Holy Spirit in the years ahead? If this is your intention, please say, "We do." And I ask all of us now to profess our faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God? I renounce them. Do you renounce the powers of this world that rebel against God? I renounce them. Do you renounce the ways of sin that draw you from God? I renounce them. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Let us pray. God, we give you thanks that through these waters of baptism, you claim us, you name us, and you make us a part of your family, the body of Christ. May you bring healing and hope to each one of us as we continue to serve and bring healing and hope to one another. In your name we pray, amen. Amen, I'm gonna come around a little as we dunk Arabella now, and you can just lean her right over, Carlos. Yeah, you got a good view? Everybody got a good view? All right. Arabella May Racette, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son. Ooh. I did a Pastor Karl there. I'm sorry. And of the Holy Spirit. Aw, sweetie, I'm sorry. Yeah. Let us pray. Holy God, in these waters, give Arabella new birth. Cleanse her from sin and raise her to eternal life. Sustain Arabella forever with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. Amen. Arabella May Racette, child of God, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Amen. Amen. Aw, you were friends again. Miss Arabella, as you chew on my fingers, I want you to remember that this light shines in you, and this light shines for all of us in the gifts that God has given Miss Arabella. She will give us and gift us as God works through here. So you can hold that. And now I'm gonna take Miss Arabella. She's not so sure. She's like, I don't know. You dunked me. Let us welcome this beautiful child of God, Arabella May Racette. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Awesome.
You did good.
Let's share God's love and God's peace with one another. Congratulations.
Can you look at the camera? Oh, you see? Yeah.
I remembered you. Come. Why don't we stand for our gospel?
The Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" And Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" And Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing?" "Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, 'He gave them bread from heaven to eat.'" Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." And Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Thank you, Pat. So, a number of years ago now, Paige and I in the wintertime like to go down to Nationwide Arena to watch the Arena Football League that we had here for a short time, the Columbus Destroyers. Joe is actually an Arena Football League veteran and MVP and star, so he knows this league well. It's a fast-paced football game, played in a hockey rink, basically with some carpet laid down, and they got pads on the side. And because it wasn't that popular in Columbus, we could afford good seats. So we got season tickets that were like fourth or fifth row, and that was good enough to, you know, feel the sweat of these guys as they were running back and forth and to hear their bones crush against the wall and all that good stuff you like, right? And it was also good for all the free swag that they give out during the games, you know, in between and things. If you're down low, you're better, more likely to get the t-shirts and the boxes of Donato's pizzas and all those things they're throwing. And one of the things that they threw out regularly for this Columbus Destroyers is they had this guy that dressed up like a hot dog, and he threw out a hot dog shirt. It was Hot Dog Wally's, I believe, was his name. And the hot dog shirt was really cool. It was just all yellow with a big hot dog down the middle. I became convinced that my life wasn't going to be complete unless I had one of these Hot Dog Wally shirts. And you couldn't buy them. You could only get them at the Columbus Destroyers thing. And they'd throw them out, and I'd miss, and, you know, it'd be close, and no cigar. And maybe in the second season of this, it came really close. So, and I'm not proud to tell you this, I had to like knock over three kids in order to grab it and get it. I looked as good as the football players down there as I got this t-shirt. And it just makes me think about those things that you think you need, that you think you want, and the extent that you go to get them, those cravings you kind of feel. And I start there because we're in the middle of the chapter 6 that Pat just read for you of this book of John. And so if you read at the beginning of chapter 6, it'd be a very familiar story if you poked around Scripture at all. It's that point where Jesus has a bunch of people that he's been talking to all day, about 5,000. And at the end of talking to them, they're hungry, so he feeds them. And it's kind of a miracle. He feeds them with bread and fish, an abundance of bread and fish. And Scripture says it's 5,000, but that's only the men. We could add times that by three, there could have been like 15,000 people there. It's a big deal. He comes up with enough bread and fish for all these people. And the thing that struck me when I read it this week was that there were 12 baskets left after he fed them. 12 baskets. That's probably symbolic of all sorts of things. But the point that I popped on was there must have been a lot of food there if after they ate, they still had food left over. Because my experience of people when they get lined up for food that just isn't going to end, they eat a lot of it. They eat a lot of it. I mean, go to a hometown buffet and see what's happening there. It's not pretty at times. When I was at Roadway Express, I had to take guys out to lunch every day. So 5 days a week, I had to take somebody different out to lunch. And these aren't like executives in wings. These are, you know, guys moving freight in the back of these businesses, and I would take them out to lunch so they would like me and, you know, use Roadway instead of Yellow or something like that. And when I take these guys out to lunch and they found out that I was paying, you know, suddenly their eyes aren't looking at the burger section of the menu anymore. They're looking at the entrees. We're ordering lobster and shrimp for lunch because that's what we do, right? When we think the food isn't going to end, we fill our bellies up. And so that there was so much food of bread and fish when Jesus fed this big crowd that there was still food left over. So it's no surprise that the next day, and that's where our scripture starts today that Pat read, the next day, these guys find Jesus again, right? The crowds find Jesus again. And the reason they find Jesus again, it's not hard to understand. It's because they're hungry again, right? Hunger cravings are one of those things that just keep on coming back over and over and over again. It's not like hot dog Wally t-shirts. It's once you get one, you kind of move on with your life. This is something you revisit. And these people, they get hungry again and again, probably because they never have enough food. Because they are likely people that live in poverty all the time. And people who live in poverty then and people that live in poverty now are often needing food. And I'm aware of this because of my work at Heart. We did a demographic study of Reynoldsburg last year for Heart, and we found out that a quarter of Reynoldsburg, it's 40,000 people roughly, 10,000 people in Reynoldsburg are likely in food emergency by Mid-Ohio Food Bank standards, which means that they make about approximately 200% of poverty level income. And Heart serves about 1,000 a month, so we're just hitting 10% of the people that are in need. And what we're doing at Heart as a church, the way we support Heart, is an extension of what Jesus was doing on that hill. He was feeding people who were physically hungry. And when they find him again, or let me go back. The last thing that we read about after Jesus feeds these people on the hill is Jesus has to flee from them because they want to make him king. Which makes complete sense, right? I mean, you would want to make somebody king who promises to fill such a basic need as hunger for you every day, day in and day out. They want to make him king. But Jesus doesn't want to be their king. He doesn't want to fill their cravings that way. Because Jesus, who's fully human and fully God, he knows how humans are wired. We don't just have one craving. Even when that craving is as basic as needing something to eat, we are full of cravings. And even after we have one filled, we get tired of the way that one gets filled after a while. You can bet that after receiving bread and fish every day for a few months, these people would be complaining to Jesus, right? I mean, can't we have some pumpernickel instead of white bread? Or is there anything else other than fish up there? But beyond that, whether they're rich or poor, that's not the only craving they have. We are people who are full of cravings. Cravings that are physical and cravings that are spiritual. And Jesus didn't come here to simply satisfy one craving. Bread that you bake in bakery could fill. Jesus came to fill all of our cravings. And not just one day, but forever. Forever. And forever is an important idea in the book of John. Forever, eternal life, right? We know what that means. That means life that doesn't end, eternal life. That's not a hard one. You don't have to be a fancy Bible scholar to get that one. But think about life that doesn't end. If the promise is that our life is not going to end and it's going to look like this for the rest of our life, that ain't a great bargain, okay? I mean, I don't want to feel like this the rest of my life. At 53, I got creaks and groans already. I can't imagine what my body's going to feel like at 453 or 853, right? That can't be what God means. And also, at 53, I still suffer from existential angst, which means, what am I doing here? And why am I here? I mean, that hasn't gone away after 5 decades on this earth. What's it going to do after 2,000 decades on this earth? When Jesus says that he's the bread of life and he's going to feed us and satisfy our cravings for the rest of our life forever, he means that we're going to find a place where we live in peace of those cravings, where those cravings don't dominate who we are, where somehow our physical needs and our spiritual needs are met. And here's the key in the book of John and the key in the church, that forever, where we find peace with those cravings, that doesn't start after we die. That's supposed to start now, the moment we're baptized, like Arabella, the moment the Holy Spirit becomes part of our life, that somehow we're going to find a place where those cravings no longer dominate us, no longer cause us to trample children to get a t-shirt that I could have probably bought someplace, surely, rather than endanger kids, right? Jesus came and said, I am the bread of life, in order to meet our physical and our spiritual needs. And I think it's important that we hear that both of those were the intention of Jesus, that our physical and our spiritual needs, they are intimately entwined. We can't be close to God if our belly is growling. Both of those have to be met. And so the church, who is the body of Christ now on earth in a way that falls short all the time, is meant to be part of this bread of life that satisfies those cravings. So the work that we're doing as a church with Heart and Joseph's Coat, that's work towards satisfying physical cravings that people have. Because it is hard to worship God when your belly's growling. But the spiritual cravings that the church seems to emphasize, those also God promises to meet us here in the midst of. That in worship, even when the songs are wrong and the sermon is more dreadful than normal, even then, God can meet us here in this water, in this bread, in this wine, in this community. But again, even the most powerful worship falls short if we enter this place and we're physically not ready to receive God and what God longs for us to have. Jesus said, I am the bread of life, and I've come to feed you forever, to help you find peace with those cravings that distract you from God, cravings that are real, not just the imagined ones, like a silly yellow t-shirt, but cravings that are core to who we are, that keep us from moving forward. And all of us, those cravings take front and center differently as we move through our lives. This morning, the physical craving that you might have is worry about a house that you could be losing. How do you focus on God and worship with that kind of worry? Or it might be a spiritual craving of a particular aloneness that you feel. Your table is abundant with food, but there's no one sitting on the other side of that table like they're used to. How does that spiritual emptiness keep you from God? Jesus said, I am the bread of life, and promised somehow, some way, to meet our cravings forever. And the hope is that that forever starts today. And that's our call, people, as the church. We can't fill everybody's cravings, that's for sure. We're a broken vessel, too. But we can at least take seriously the hope that people would find the bread of life now, and in that bread of life be moved towards peace with all the distractions, real and imagined, that keep us from God. And that's what I hope you find today. That somehow in the midst of this worship service, when you come forward with your hands out to receive this bread baked at Great Harvest in Westerville, when you come forward with brothers and sisters next to you, that you'll find a connection and a care for you, where you're at, and what you need right now. And maybe that'll lead us to ask questions of each other, of what craving you're longing for. And maybe we'll find a way to be Christ for each other. That this bread that we receive becomes bread that we share. Amen. you stand and pray with me? Holy God, meet us in this place as we come forward with outstretched hands. We give thanks for the promise of Jesus to be here when we gather and we call upon him. For that was the promise he made to his disciples on the night he was betrayed. For he took bread and broke it and gave thanks, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body and it's been given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup and he blessed it and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a sign of the new covenant shed in my blood, for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink this wine, we are proclaiming the very mystery of faith, that Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. Holy God, bread of life, meet us in this place. Satisfy our cravings, physical and spiritual. We pray for those in our community who are sick or ill. Kimberly and Meg, Harlan, Christine, Harold, Susan, Lauren, Holly, Daryl, Mary, Sue, Bev, Julie, Karen, Grant, Karen, Jack, Debbie. Pray for all those who are grieving. Linda Ickes at the loss of her stepmother, family of Harold Kaler, the family of Kathleen Sackett, the family of Lane Sampson. We name others now whose physical cravings are real and spiritual cravings are real. Bread of life, feed us this morning. Make us whole. Bring us peace. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. We'll commune our assistants first, and then bring this meal forward for everyone to eat. We've got a lot of visitors here today. Let me tell you that you are invited to this meal. This isn't a Lutheran meal. This is Christ's meal. God promises to be present here, and he wants to meet all children of God in this space. So come forward and eat with us, please. We serve by intinction, where we give you the bread in the center, and then you go to the right or the left, and you can dip the bread into the wine and take both at the same time, or you could eat the bread, and there's a large cup, and you can drink the wine fully. That's the second cup. Come and eat.
Way down in Egypt land.
Let my people go.
Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen. Let us pray. God, strengthened by the bread of heaven, may we go out, send us to feed one another. In your name we pray. Amen. A few announcements this morning. We have begun the season of Lent, so Wednesday nights, all are invited to join us at 7:30 for a nice service of prayer and worship. It's a good time through the season of Lent to just come together and reflect. We'll be going through the Psalms on those nights, reflecting on the Psalms. So as you saw when you walked in the Welcome Center, there's a coloring table out there. And on the what they are, the coloring sheets are for the Psalms that we're doing. So there'll be a coloring sheet for the Psalm for the following week. So last week we put out Psalms for what we'll be doing this week. And the ones out on the table now are for the Psalm for next week. So you're invited to grab a sheet, have your kids sit down, adults join them, sit with them, bring one home, all that kind of stuff. And then you can pin them to the board out there and we can see each other's creativity. You're also welcome to come to class at 6:30. Adult Ed started last week on faith, sexism, and justice, so you're welcome to come join us with that, as well as all the different programs that go on, and the meal at 5:30. Also, next week on Sunday is the Getting to Know You party. So this is hosted by Kay and Doug Arnold. It's just a time for all of us to get to know one another from the different services. Sometimes we get siloed into just knowing people in our service. So this is a good way to get to know others over food and conversation. So you can sign up for that in the Welcome Center. We also have, every year or every other year, we try and do a survey for the pastors to give us feedback on how you experience us in the various ministries of the church. So you can grab a hard copy that's out in the Welcome Center, but even better is to do it online. So if you go to the Messiah website, there'll be a link there, and you can just hit that link and fill it out. We'll have about a period of a month to fill that out. So help us out with that and give us some feedback. And also, announcement, we have our longtime member, Lane Sampson, as you heard in prayers. He died, this morning, and his service will probably be on Wednesday morning. And we also had our member, Kathleen Sackett, who moved last year. She died very suddenly last week. So keep both those families in your prayers. Her services will be on Wednesday morning in Ashland, Peace Lutheran. And this is actually the pastor there is our former LIC student, Karen. So if you'd like more information, we'll be sending that out. And with that, Pastor Karl.
Yeah, I'd like Kevin and Laurel to stand up. We're going to send them off. They are in the sandwich generation, right, with older parents and adult kids. And they're going to be going to Phoenix to take care of their Laurel's father and his wife, who are in their 90s. And they might be gone 3 months or they might be gone 3 years. So they're going to rent their house here and we're going to send them off. And I'd like for us to stand up and we can pray for them as we leave these good people part of our church. The Holy Spirit be with Kevin and Laurel as they travel to Arizona. Bless them in this good work that they're doing for their family. May they bear the bread of life, Lord, that satisfies all of our cravings and brings us peace. Amen. Okay. Amen. Good things. For that, let's have our blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you all with favor and grant you God's peace. Amen.
I love.
member, Bessie McGarvey, is going to be going up to Kathleen's funeral in Ashland. She has 3 spaces, so if you're interested, you can speak with her. Go in peace and serve the Lord. And next week,
bring a friend.
Amen.
I want to.